May I start? Okay, let's finish this. I am a little bit late, but okay, it's a life. So this is a particular case of the equation that I have obtained for the frame can be used for interfaces. All right, I gave you two examples. One is Rayleigh-Taylor instability, and the other is the gravity waves. These are very old problems. As I told you, gravity waves were analyzed in that term, not exactly in that term, but this result was obtained already by Newton, you know, 17th century. So now let me give you a very a much recent phenomena, which is called the Matthews equation. What is it? It's a similar equation as this one, but where the acceleration is oscillating in time with a frequency. The steady value of the acceleration, and I make the acceleration oscillating in time. Do you know what kind of phenomena this is going to describe? The pendulum, when you oscillate a pendulum, you know, there are two experiments. One where you see this is a stick which is in an unstable position. You can't make this stick stable by oscillating like that. For example, if you take a stick and you may keep the stick vertical by this. So this is described by this equation, Matthews equation. This Matthews equation is also important to describe another instability mechanism. It is a stabilizing mechanism in some time, a destabilizing mechanism in other time. For example, you take a plate filled of water, right, with walls and water, and shake it. What do you see? Small structure on it. And this is described by this equation. And this equation is going to be very important for the interaction of the frame with the acoustics of a tube. This is why I mentioned now, all right? It's a little bit more complicated, but this is the Matthews equation. And this Matthews equation, you know, is a difficult equation to solve, and the solution is known since the last century, 1950, something like that. Very nice equation. Very simple, but a lot of information in it. All right. Now, I am back to the Darieux-Landau instability here. And now, in this equation, I use a decomposition for tilde alpha. I use exponential alpha t. See, I use this decomposition. I look proportional to exponential sigma t, and I am looking for this sigma, which is the growth rate. If the real part is positive, it's unstable. If it is negative, it is stable. And is there any frequency or not? The answer is simple. You obtain a second order algebraic equation for sigma. So this is easy to solve, you know. This is the only equation I know how to solve simply. And you obtain here the result. In terms of sigma divided by ULK, as I told you, you cannot have another grouping. You know, you should, for dimensional analysis, you end up with a number which is the growth rate divided by the flow velocity times the wave number. The wave number is given, okay? And you ask for the growth rate, and you obtain this number. And okay, there is one stable solution I am not interested in. I am interested in the unstable solution, which is a plus sign here, and where The VB here is, I did not write that, is VB, it is not written? Okay, see, it is here, is the ratio of the density, okay? Is a number larger than unity. So you obtain the number, that's all. Lot of work for a few things, okay? But, so, you can, okay, it is interesting to look at different limits. For example, if the density, if there is a very large density ratio, this equation simplifies to this equation, which is much more easy to retain, to keep in mind, say that sigma is square root of UBUL times K. Very good, very simply too. This is only valid for you obtain that from this when you take this limit. And in the opposite limit, where the difference of density is small, you find simply the difference of the velocity here as a factor divided by two. This is two limits that are easy to keep in mind. Okay? Yes, but now let's be back to the question of Landau. What happens for the very small wavelength? Something should be wrong there. You cannot have, the argument of Landau was the following. Shorter is the wavelength, stronger is the instability. So the flame is going to break. And Zeldovich say, go to the lab and you will see that it's not right. And what happened? But what happened that you have to stop this analysis when the disturbance become of the order, the wavelength become of the order of the flame thickness, because this analysis was only right for wavelengths much larger than the flame thickness, so that you neglect the flame thickness. Now, you cannot neglect the flame thickness in the case of very small wavelength. So you should add something there, and this is something on what I have worked for many hours when I was young, solving this problem, the full problem, to have an answer to this question around 82, 81, 79, 81. I did a lot of work on that with other people. Now, the idea is the following. You know, here I have written, this is a sketch of a flame. This is a flame thickness here, you know. And now I have a wavelength which is of the order of the flame thickness. What is the problem here? So you see now, in green here you have the profile of the concentration of the limiting species. In red, you have the profile of temperature, okay? And you see that you have transverse, because of the shift of this profile, you are inducing transverse diffusive flux. And these transverse diffusive flux are competing to change the temperature locally. And if you change the temperature, you change the flame speed, as you see, because this is very sensitive to the flame speed. So this mechanism is going to be very strongly either stabilizing or not stabilizing. It depends. Let me assume that it is stabilizing. you will see in the next lecture that it can be destabilizing also, and this is a second instability of the flame. Now, if you assume, you know, it's, let me give you a rough argument that you may understand easily. You know, if I have a kind of diffusion equation coming from this, because the mechanism that are involved in this effect, this mechanism is diffusion. So what you can expect is that the result of this mechanism is going to give you a kind of diffusion equation for alpha. And if it is the case, you know, this gives you a minus, and if the coefficient is positive, this is what is difficult to guess, Now you have a relaxation phenomena which is minus k square, because it is a second derivative in space. And so you have a sigma which is k is a modulus of the wave number. Be careful. Here it is a modulus of the wave number. Eh? It is not written somewhere, yes, but you should be careful with that. Eh? Here also, it's a modulus of the wave vector. So k, this is a Darieux-Landau instability. And then when the wavelengths, wave number become large, the k square term dominate the k term. So Landau is here, Darieux-Landau is here, and with the k square term, you have this. And you are going, now this is a growth rate, and you are going to stabilize the small wavelengths. So you see, as soon as the wavelengths become sufficiently small, or say that the wave number becomes sufficiently large, you have to take into account these transverse diffusion effects. And this is going to stabilize your flame for the small wavelengths. You stay unstable in a large wavelength range. You stay unstable, but not in the short wavelength. You know, large k, you are stable. All right? Let's give you a rough idea of what the situation is going to be when you take into account the finite flame signals, right? Okay. Okay, curvature FM. I am going to skip this just to give you the result. Okay. I skip the detail. Now, you know, because this analysis here is a fairly simplified analysis of the complex problem that is too complex to present here. Just what I say is the following. The point I have to change in the analysis is the fact that when you wrinkle the flame with a wavelength which become of the order of the flame thickness, you cannot say that the mass flux is going to keep to be the same as for the planar flame. You change it because you have this transverse flux that change the balance of everything. So now you change, you are going to write that this is non-zero, but for a simplified analysis, you say that mass flux variation is the same of both sides, and this is wrong. This is why the full analysis is complicated. And because I will give you some better insight in this problem later on. So now you assume that now you have a relaxation, a modification of this mass flux due to the curvature with assuming that this number is positive. If you put that now in the analysis, you reduce the analysis the same, you obtain this equation. The only modification that you obtain is that you have an extra k term, in fact, k squared term here, and this here it is a k squared term. You have an extra term higher in power of k here, coming, you know, from this diffusive damping. Okay? You have an extra term. So this is the same. Okay, you might forget about this extra term. It does not play an interesting role. It just changed a little bit since, but it is not important. So just you have an extra term in the constant coefficient here. No, okay. In the coefficient in front of tilde alpha here. Not. I neglect this modification in the first derivative. It's not very. It does not play any role. Now, I have written here this equation, the same second order equation, with this damping effect here. And I use a reduce formulation in order to get rid of all the unusual parameters. For example, my growth rate now is reduced with the transit time across the flame. The transit time across the flame is simply the flame thickness divided by the flame velocity. Okay? tau L, this tau is simply the transit time across the flame, which is, I say again, it is the flame thickness divided by the flame velocity. All right? I use this kappa, I use the reduced wave number by the flame thickness. Okay? And here I use this G1 is the gravity. This is a Froude, the inverse. Alors, be careful in the literature. This is called sometimes Froude square. Sometimes it is called minus Froude, 1/Froude square. Okay, you have a lot of different definitions of the Froude number in the literature. I have used here this G1 because this G1 is proportional to G, is without dimension. You know, it's the G without dimension. Is the acceleration, and Km is a coefficient that appears in front of that when I write the equation in the non-dimensional form. So this non-dimensional form is interesting. For what reason? Now, if you look, you know, what you are interested in, now I am going to show you that the acceleration coupled with the curvature effect can stabilize the frame at all wavelengths, which means that you may produce a planar flame freely propagating in some particular conditions. And now, so what I say is that if there is a transition from stable to unstable, this transition should occur for the growth rate going through zero, because growth rate negative, I am stable. Growth rate positive, I am unstable. And I assume that there is no imaginary part, because I know that there is no imaginary part in this problem, which was wrong for the Rayleigh-Taylor problem. But here, I know that there is no. So, you know, in such a way that, OK, I said, but oh, wait. If I look for the stability limits, which correspond to sigma equals zero, growth rate equals zero, just I have to consider the term here, because this term disappears, sigma s equals zero here. And I have just to look at this term, it should be zero. And now when you look to this term, you see there is there is a competition. So the sign of g is depending where you are, if you are propagating upwards or downwards. Here I have used a sign for a downward propagation, all right? And so this G naught is positive, downward propagation. This is negative. This term, minus K squared divided by Km, is also negative. And I have a positive term, K, which results from the Zeldin-Riolando analysis, in fact. K, you know, everything which is proportional to kappa, is due to Landau Dario instability. So here is a gravity effect. Here, this term is the Dario Landau instability effect, and this is a stabilizing effect at small wavelength. So here again, okay, now I have written, you know, this equation, the solution of this equation for different values of G, zero in terms of K. So this is the result for S or sigma, I don't know what I put here, S or sigma, whatever it is. And this curve has the solution of this equation. What do you see? When the acceleration is very strong, you know, acceleration minus G naught are going to stabilize the small K, that is the long wavelength, when I propagate downward, not upward. Upward, it will be just the opposite. And so this acceleration here stabilizes the long wavelengths. The diffusive term here, kappa square or K square, stabilizes the short wavelengths, which is the large K, in such a way that when this G is sufficiently large, I am stable, whatever be the wavelength. Then I decrease G. Now, if G equals zero, I be back here with the Darieux lambda analysis plus diffusion, the plus diffusion term. And you see for G, and this G is the inverse of the Froude number, is proportional to the square, the inverse of the square of the flame velocity. So what does that mean? Increasing G means decreasing G is in that direction upward, means increasing the flame velocity. So, in short, when the flame velocity is small, you can have a flame propagating downward completely flat. And this was first observed in Marseille, in the lab in Marseille around 81, 82. And Zeldovich was very, he enjoyed that. You know, Zeldovich, when he saw this result, he said, oh my goodness, just a freely propagating flame. But in fact, to tell the truth, this was understood by another physicist called, US physicist called Mark Stein. Okay, Mark Stein do not have a good, his analysis was semi-phenomenological, but the idea was there in about 65. This man was also very good. He was not recognized at its real value, to my opinion. So, okay, so so when you are a flame propagating, okay, and this is a wave number for sigma equals zero, you know, this you have the solution of this equation, sigma equals zero, give you the two marginal wave number, and for when. Okay, so here is the result of the experiment of Boyer, Kinard, Boyer, and Sirby in Marseille, where they have this flame. And why it is so interesting from an experimental point of view to have a freely propagating flame stabilized in the laboratory without a burner, you know, without a plug, without nothing. Just this is because now if you excite this flame by a slight turbulence, you may study the response of that flame. You may also study the bifurcation. What is the bifurcation? In this point here, you know, as soon as you cross here, you see this cellular structure that appear, and a lot of work were developed to study this bifurcation and to compare with the theoretical result, just to be sure that we have the right description of the flame. All right? Now, if I propagate upwards, it is just the opposite. Now I start here, you know, the G is going to give you a constant value here, which is, and you have the bubble, and it looks like a bubble. All right, so this is the end of this lecture. So now I am moving. Where are my glasses? Yeah, there are. I am moving to the second instability that I want to describe. What does that mean? Okay. So, lecture five. Okay, it works. So, now I like to describe a quite different instability of a quite different nature. I told you that to stabilize the large wave, the small wavelength, I use diffusive phenomena. But I told you also to be sure that the coefficient is positive. It turns out that this coefficient can be negative. So if you have an equation like that, dt alpha equal a coefficient A, d is positive, d over dy alpha. And if A become negative, This is going to be strongly unstable. In order to see that, you have just to take the sigma here, and you have minus a k square, and this a is negative, gives you a plus a k plus term k square. So it's just the opposite. So you know, a diffusion equation is stabilizing, is relaxing, if the diffusion coefficient is positive, and it is unstable if the coefficient diffusion is negative. It turns out that now, you see, I have this. This is a sketch of the profile of the flame. Red is the temperature, reduced temperature. Blue is the reduced mass fraction. Okay. Now, Now you see, I use again this sketch of the wrinkled flame. There are this transverse flux are going to change the equilibrium of the temperature, and so to change the flame temperature, the temperature at the reaction zone. If you change the temperature at the reaction zone, you are strongly changing the flame velocity. So to study this problem, but in fact, there are two effects that modify the inner flame structure. You have the transverse diffusion, but what makes the problem difficult is that you have also the transverse convection, you know, because of the deflection of the streamline. Deflection of streamline is going to put a gradient of flow velocity in the transverse direction. And this is going to change also the equilibrium of temperature and spaces. Okay? So this is why the problem is not easy to do. And in fact, it wasn't only solved, let's say, 30 years ago. So it's not new, huh? But so what I am going to show to do you for you is to solve the one-dimensional, one-step problem, as I did for the flame speed in the analysis of Zeldovich. And so I use the same model, but I have to tell you that this model is very particular. For that, not for the flame propagation, that's okay. But for the stability, for the thermal diffusive instability, it is a little bit particular. And we have found very recently that when you use a different model, you have a different result. But different qualitatively, not quantitatively. Qualitatively, this is a you will see that is a paper that I it's a work I did with Grania 2 years ago. It's just published. So let me first introduce for you what is a stretch rate and the strain and curvature of a flame. In order, before to look to a flame, let me look to a passive interface. What is a passive interface? Okay. This is an interface that is convected by the flow. There is no flow crossing the interface. All right? And I put that in a turbulent flow. And I want to see something. What happened to this flame? Okay, so if because I have a flame, this is an elementary. I take an elementary surface delta square s, and the growth or damp or the stretch rate of the surface is defined by the inverse of this time, which is the time derivative of the element of surface area. Delta S divided by delta S squared, just to have the inverse of a time. And I assume that each point of the flame is propagating with an inhomogeneous flow, which is a given quantity. And I want to compute to have an expression for this growth rate. To do that, I picked the idea from Batchelor, in fact, from the book of Batchelor. The best thing to do is to consider a volume. Why? Because if you consider a volume, you have the continuity equation that tells you that the rate of change when you have an incompressible flow, the rate of change of the volume is simply given by the continuity equation, which is the divergence of the flow velocity. So you know the rate of change of the volume. What you want to know is the rate of change of the surface. But this is easy. You consider that the volume is an elementary surface multiplied by a thickness, normal direction. Okay? Now, from this equation, it's you derivatives, you take the time derivative of this equation, and you have the sum of the growth rate of the volume equals the growth rate of the surface times the growth rate, growth or damping, depends on the sign, of the thickness of your material, okay, of your elementary volume. And now, the evolution in the normal direction is simply the difference of velocity time scalar by the normal and the difference shifted by the difference of normal in the normal direction due to delta here, okay? So in the normal direction. This is the rate of change of the thickness. Now, if I introduce this expression here and this expression here, I got the rate of change of the surface. So to do that, I have to use the fact that the thickness is small compared to the characteristic length of variation of my flow. You see, I use this approximation so that I may use a Taylor expansion here in this difference here of velocity from bottom to top. And I use this Taylor expansion here so that the rate of change of the thickness is simply given by a double contraction of the normal with a tensor, which is the stress tensor of the flow, you know? So this is a very simple, you find that very easily. And so that now, when you put together this result and this result, you find out the rate, the stretch rate of an elementary surface, which is simply convected by the flow, okay? In terms of the characteristic of the flow. This is a simple geometrical analysis. When you deal with a frame, the only thing you have to do is to take into account that the flow that is stretching the frame is not the flow velocity in the laboratory frame, but it is the flow velocity relative to the frame. If you take into account that, you put that in it, and you obtain, with playing with some geometrical relation, you obtain the linear growth rate or damping rate of a frame, the stretch rate of a frame. And it turns out that because you are I have written that in terms of the upstream flow. Okay? So one has to be careful with that. But for the upstream flow, because I am incompressible outside the flame, the divergence is zero. So I found out I have only this equation. And elementary differential geometry tells you that the divergence of the normal is simply the mean radius, curvature radius of the flame. This result is, okay, forget about. This result here is going from, I think, it's a mathematical result. So in that, so the stretch rate of a flame in terms of the upstream flow takes this form, simply. And this form tells you that you have two effects. One effect is a curvature effect of the flame. This is clearly understood. If you have a flame that propagates normal to its surface, you change the surface. So this term here, UL over R, is the rate just because you propagate in the normal direction. All right, time rate of evolution of the surface. And the other, okay, this term, for example, is a case when you have an imploding or converging flame, spherical flame. The gas, the fresh mixture is at rest. So if it is at rest, because of geometrical consideration, you cannot have motion here, because you are incompressible. Eh? Compressible, it will be different. But you are incompressible approximation. So in that case, this term disappears here, and you have only the curvature term. And this, you have the surface that is decreasing when the flame propagates inward, because the surface is decreasing, okay? Because you are propagating inward. This is the effect. So there's the effect. The other effect, it has nothing to do with the curvature of the front. It has to do with the gradient of the flow. For example, if you have a flow which is blown on a wall, a fresh mixture, you have a stagnation point here, and you may have a planar flame because the stagnation point is very stabilizing. This is another problem that I have no time to describe, but you may have a very planar flame here, which is stretched only by the transverse gradient of the flow. So you have to keep in mind only these two effects. Curvature effect, we change the surface because of the normal propagation, and strain rate, due to the inhomogeneous flow that you may have. All right? Okay. This is, okay. Now, what is important is to do the analysis of such flames in presence of an inhomogeneous flow and to find out what will be the difference of the normal burning velocity minus the planar velocity, which is not disturbed by any curvature or any flow. It turns out that I should have had, you see, there is another group of people in United States, Moshe Matalon, at the same time produce a little bit later the same result. That it is easy, not easy. It's a lot of calculation. But to find out that if you used one-step flame model, hard decomposed in product, used by Zeldovich, you obtain a number here in front of this stretch rate here, reduced by the transit time across the flame to be non-dimensional. And this number is called what? Because it's called the Markstein number, because Markstein was the first to introduce this number in a phenomenological point of view. What we did is to compute this number in terms of the characteristic of the mixture. What kind of mixture, diffusive property, and so on. We did that around 80. And here I give you now, it's forget about the detail. This number here, in this expression here, which was obtained by with Pedro Garcia, one has many things. First of all, we take into account what I this effect, which is not only diffusion effect, but which is an effect which is due to the transverse, because of the deflection of the lid, transverse convection. We take into account that, not only the diffusion, but also, okay. And you know, the effect, if you want to have only the effect of the diffusion, you will find that M is beta Lewis minus 1 and plus 2 divided by 2 for the Markshein number. But it is a little bit more complicated when you take into account the fact that the transverse flow is also modifying the flame surface, the flame structure. Excuse me. Now, very recently, not very recently, 4 years ago already, but the time is going so fast for me, that we redo a similar analysis, the same analysis, but taking into account a multiple component. And then you change now, from a quantitative point of view, the result. Why? Because now, as it was anticipated by, we have anticipated that with Guy Joulin, that in fact these two terms are quite different terms, you know, a geometrical term and stretch rate, rain. And, the flow strain rate is a very different mechanism than the flow, the front curvature. Why it is the same Markshein number that we obtained in 82? And everybody use that now, huh? One Markshein number, but that's wrong. There are two Markshein numbers when the frame is not as simple as one step. And you have two Markshein numbers, one for the front curvature and one for the flow. And but one has to be careful now, because the second curvature now is not easy to define, because it will depend where you located the gradient, you know, inside the flame. You know, because this gradient is going to change across the flame. So where do you have to take this? So in few words, what is constant is the product of this term times the flow strain rate. This should be constant because this should affect the normal burning velocity relative to the fresh mixture. Here also you have to be careful, because the problem is a multidimensional problem, and it is not easy to solve this problem. But I want just to give you a flavor of the result. I don't want to give you the detail. I cannot do the result in so short time. So, in fact, there is no problem with this term, because the curvature, there is no modification or the one modification, because you are already small here, and so there is no modification if you take the curvature here or here, because this is giving you a correction of the following order. But this is not the case for the flow strain rate. It changes for the unity inside the flame. So where to take this center? So you have to perform a very sophisticated analysis, and then you get the right answer. So this is just to tell you that there are, to summarize, in fact, there are two Markshein numbers. We are responsible for the fact that there is only one with Markshein, because we found only one for the simple reaction rate hard on P. But now, here you have a change when this is very special result. And the second Markshein number, you have difficulty to define it properly. You have to be careful where to define it, especially when you do experiment. One has to be very careful. Not only that, but there is another difficulty, that the Markshein number in the burn gas is not the Markshein number in the fresh mixture. once again, because of the change of flame structure across the flame. And yes, there are many mistakes in the literature, in experimentalists, that confuse the two. And you should be careful, because this number is varying of all the unity. So, all right. So this is just to give you some. So the two. Okay, these two numbers are different, and so on and so on. But for example, if you have a flame, for example, the simple case will be what is steady for a steady flame. For example, this you have a source, and you have a spherical source where the premixed gas flow out, point source, you're a spherical, okay, you have a spherical flame. Or you may do also for but it is more difficult, for a cylindrical. But you have a spherical flame, steady. In that case, when you measure the change of the flame velocity relative to the planar case, relative to the fresh mixture, be careful, because also it's different on the burnt side. Now, it turns out that you find that the strain rate can be expressed in terms of the radius, and now you have the difference of the two Marstein numbers that appear here. So this is a very nice experiment, but unfortunately, it is difficult, and I don't know any result of this experiment. But now, if you have an expanding flame, in the expanding flame, what is very interesting, it is that the burned gas is at rest because of the geometrical. It's like when I have a flame propagating in a tube, in planar flame, and propagating from the closed or a closed end to the open end. And here the flame is at rest. So in that case, it is very useful not to consider this Marstein number that is going to appear, because the burned gases is at rest when you are working in the burned gas. So so I have maybe written from this is the Marstein number, spherical Marstein number plus is in the burned gases that you have that appear now as a difference of the measuring the difference of the burn flame velocity, the relative difference of the burn flame velocity. So, you know, you have two kinds of experiments that in principle or in numerics, for example, you can check out this result. Now, let me go to the... I have to... There is a, no, it's time to break, no?